And I'm going to go straight now to our second panel of the day, which is entitled Approaches to Future Health Cooperation on the Island. So this panel will discuss established areas of North-South cooperation on health, the benefits that have been delivered for patients through the shared approach on agreed areas of cooperation, and with a focus on what works and what lessons have been learned and how we can kind of do more together in some areas. So this panel is made up of Damien McCallion, who is the HSE National Director for the COVID-19 Vaccination Programme, and he's Director General of CAUT, Cooperation Working Together, which is a 25-year-old partnership between the Health and Social Care Services in Northern Ireland and the Republic, which facilitates cross-border collaborative healthcare. We also have Dr. Len O'Hagan, who is Chair of the All-Ireland Congenital Heart Disease Network, and he has extensive international management, governance and directorial experience in both the private and public sector. And finally, we have Professor Deirdre Heenan, who is Professor of Social Policy at Ulster University, who will discuss her research on cross-border healthcare, which was conducted specifically for this dialogue, and which includes suggestions of future areas for North-South cooperation, based on consultations with a range of medical practitioners and experts. So we're all excited to hear about that research. So firstly, I'm going to come to you, Damien, please, for your introductory remarks.
Good morning and welcome to the Shared Island event. My name is Damien McCallion and I'm the Chairperson and Director General of CAUT. CAUT is a cross-border body and it comprises of statutory health and social care providers in the Republic of Ireland and in Northern Ireland. In the Republic of Ireland, it includes the Health Service Executive, and in Northern Ireland, the Western and Southern Trusts, which are along the border area, the Health and Social Care Board, and the Public Health Agency in Northern Ireland. CAUT has been in place for over 25 years and was formed as a result of a partnership between the statutory health providers in North and South. It is operated across the border area, providing services and looking to develop services for people who live in the border region. It's a partnership, it's not a legal entity, and part of the rationale at the time was that it would ensure that the partners, the people who provide the services, all had an equal stake and footing in ensuring the cause was successful, and it wasn't another agency or another entity. That has worked well, and the collaboration has been one of the cornerstones of the reasons why CAUT has succeeded in helping to deliver services across the border region. Ultimately, the purpose of CAUT is to improve the lives of people, the health and social care and well-being of people who live in the border regions. This has been founded based on partnership between the agencies and also by being able to utilise European Union funding through what's called the Regional Development Programme or Interreg Programme. This has been the cornerstone of many of the initiatives that CAUT has managed to develop over the last 25 years. To give you some examples, these have been projects in sectors such as our emergency care services. There's currently a project developing community paramedics in Northern Ireland, the Republic of Ireland, and looking at how they can assist in primary care to keep people at home and prevent people having to go to hospital. But projects run across many diverse areas: mental health services, children's services, older person services, primary care, disability services, social inclusion services. A wide range of projects over those years have been developed, and many of those have been what we call mainstreamed. In other words, they've been able to be turned into projects that continue and continue to provide support for people in the border area. Other aspects of CAUT is also about facilitating and supporting other developments along the border, aside from EU funding. And the partnership model has worked very well. Key to this as well is community and voluntary sector, who are also involved in many of the projects. So while CAUT facilitates and leads these projects, there are many other agencies and bodies involved. And give another example, in recent times, a lot of work has been done in terms of the recovery colleges. This is a new model of care for mental health services. And again, we've seen examples of this develop both north and south. And the collaboration and learning that comes from working together in different jurisdictions also proves invaluable in achieving that. Going forward, there are many challenges. We've seen this year the challenge of COVID and over the last 18 months. We've also had Brexit, and all of these have presented challenges to CAUT in terms of continuing to do its work along the border area. We've overcome these. In some cases, some of the work that we've been doing has facilitated us through COVID. Some of the technologies that we were looking to use for remote consultations proved invaluable in the response to the pandemic. I would say, if anything, the pandemic has made the partnership stronger and made the desire for collaboration, but ultimately not for collaboration's sake. it really is all about trying to ensure that there are sensible things that we need to do that are helpful to patients, helpful to services, and helpful to those staff that are working in them, particularly when you look at what healthcare staff have been through over the last year. There are lots of challenges in implementing these projects, not least in terms of the different statutory systems, the different focus, different priorities, perhaps at different points in time. But I would say that all of these, in our experience, can be overcome through working together to try and ultimately improve the lives of people along the border corridor. I hope you enjoy the day.
Thank you, Damien, for those remarks and for your insight into what CULT does and why it works so well and its many achievements to date. And now we're going to head over to you, Len, please, for your introductory remarks.
Thanks, Priscilla. My name is Len O'Hagan, and I'm chair of the All-Ireland Congenital Heart Disease Network. The network was established in 2015 at a time when, unfortunately, dozens of sick children and their families had to travel from Northern Ireland to London and Birmingham for life-saving surgery. Travel in these circumstances increased the clinical risk for the children and imposed unacceptable financial and emotional burdens on the family, who were forced to spend weeks supporting their children at their bedsides. A sustainable solution was required, and the two health ministers on the island agreed to form a network with the objective of providing safe, quality care as close to the patient's home as possible to increase access and deliver value for both patient and provider. That objective has now been achieved. So it might be useful today to outline the milestones on our journey that has resulted in all congenital heart disease surgery and hybrid lab interventions taking place on the island. A network of paediatricians with expertise in cardiology have been established in 7 hospitals across the island. Joint training programs for doctors and nurses have also been established, and joint research professors are being appointed. We first established a network board to include family representatives, clinicians, nurses, hospital executives, departmental officials, and a non-medical independent chair. The learning was that clinical leadership, patients' voices, and an independent chair are vital in any complex cross-border initiative to provide challenge, mediation, and adherence to best governance practice, particularly as the network has no explicit legislative power. Our model is about goodwill and cooperation. The board had a clear purpose and a vision. We then developed a strategy to mobilize and inspire the many hundreds of people who make up the network, which is now developed to become a true partnership across the island to achieve better patient outcomes for children and their families. The lesson we learned was that for any All-Ireland health initiative to work, an inspirational purpose and vision together with a patient-focused strategy is essential. With the governance, the vision, the purpose and the strategy agreed, we formulated a detailed business plan which clearly demonstrated the benefits and costs and then negotiated a multi-million, multi-year investment. For an All-Ireland health initiative to work, it must have full ministerial and departmental support. And that support can only be real if it manifests itself in new additional multi-year funding. So we developed a world-class CHD service for the island of Ireland through our unique cross-jurisdictional and multidisciplinary network in which our family representatives are central. Our network is a cooperative structure that operates on soft power alone. It is an interconnected group coalescing around a noble shared purpose. The network is diverse and is collectively able to innovate and be creative. Leadership is distributed across members, and relationships between members are defined by reciprocity and exchange. Our achievement on paper is the creation of the first cross-jurisdictional clinical service in the world. Our achievement in reality is that lives have been saved, and many children and their families have been given a second chance at life and hope for the future. It is a privilege to be part of something so special.
Thank you, Len. There can be no doubt about what an amazing and vital achievement the All-Ireland Congenital Heart Disease Network is and the huge breadth of work involved to make that an actual reality. I mean, the sheer determination of you, your colleagues and patients, I mean, really has to be commended. but hopefully now there's a blueprint so that other similar services could potentially be put in place in the future. And now, finally, over to you, Deirdre, for your opening remarks and your research findings, which I'm very interested in hearing more about.
Thanks, Priscilla, and good morning. My name is Professor Deirdre Heenan. I'm Professor of Social Policy at Ulster University and also a Senior Associate at Nuffield Trust. In my opening remarks, I wanted to reflect on a small-scale scoping study that I've undertaken for the Shared Island Unit. The scoping study was really trying to get some information around cross-border collaboration, but in a qualitative basis. So speaking to 49 individuals who had been involved in this area, whether as policymakers, academics, or clinicians. And from this research, three main themes emerged, and I just very quickly wanted to reflect on those. Number one was around enthusiasm. The second one was about a strategic overview, and the third one was around sharing knowledge and information. So in terms of the first one, there was a huge amount of enthusiasm for further investigation of the potential for collaboration. Individuals talked about collaboration being the lifeblood of healthcare, something that you would naturally do. In fact, the question would be, why would you not, as we are facing similar challenges? And as an island, perhaps we could have a critical mass to deliver some services that we just simply couldn't deliver individually. And we may be able to deliver higher quality, more specialized services as an island. Secondly, though, there was a real concern about a lack of strategic overview and framework for this type of work. It was suggested that the mechanisms that were needed to support this type of work simply weren't there. So whilst politicians at the highest level had talked about supporting collaboration on the island, really it was felt there wasn't much evidence of this in recent policy reviews, for example, and that caused a great degree of frustration. Where there had been successes, and there had been remarkable successes, they were often driven by individuals rather than following policy initiatives. Thirdly, then, there was an issue around the sharing of information and data systems. A feeling that this type of work involved people working together, but there wasn't an obvious vehicle as to where this type of work was happening. And so it was difficult to know what areas of academic research were being pursued. Were there gaps? Were there duplications? How would you get up-to-date information? And how could you go and find other advocates or champions in this area of work, people that you could work with and collaborate with? But as an overview, there were many areas that were presented as opportunities for future work, such as mental health, perinatal mental health, dialysis, cardiac care, rare diseases, and a real belief that if we work together in some of those areas, we might be able to deliver the best possible outcomes for people on this island, because a key overarching theme within the research was this shouldn't be about politics or structures, but really about delivering the best outcomes for people on this island.
Thank you, Deirdre, for sharing your very important research findings. Plenty of food for thought there for policymakers, hopefully. And obviously, it's very heartening to see the enthusiasm of those surveyed for further collaboration, and the key point that it is all about delivering the best outcomes possible for all people on this island. So now we're going to go into the question section of this panel. And just a reminder for you watching this at home that you can enter questions into the chat box and raise your hand, and I will try to come to as many of you as possible to ask your question live to the panel. Now, the first question that we have in today is from Evelyn Mulroe from Cancer Trials Ireland. So I'm going to go to you now, Evelyn, please, to ask your question to the panel.
Thank you, Priscilla, and thank you, everyone, for a fantastic session so far this morning. It's a real privilege to be here as a border county woman. I'm from Monaghan, and it's from on that note I want to talk about this, because I also run Cancer Trials Ireland. And when we heard from Dr. Black earlier, you know, he talked about how the work of GPs have changed and has become more about managing chronic diseases than maybe it did 30 years ago. And I'm really happy to say cancer is a chronic disease for many now, which it wasn't 30 years ago. But what I would say about that from a patient perspective is, if you draw a horizontal line on a map from Galway to Dublin, there are no centres of excellence in cancer to the north of that map except Belfast. So if you live in Donegal, you live in Fermanagh, you live in Monaghan, you know, you're looking at the centre south of the country. And I suppose that's something we want to look at from a Cancer Trials Ireland point of view. We already run trials on both sides of the border. And we work with the Northern Ireland Cancer Trials Unit in Belfast. But for patients and for our clinicians who see patients, say in Cork or in Donegal or in Derry, it's very difficult for patients to travel across borders to access cancer trials, but it's also difficult for them to access treatment cross border. And I will say that our oncologist community have said that in the last, you know, in the last 6 months, they've seen a lot of patients traveling to try and access trials privately in the south of Ireland. So I suppose my question today is, how do we develop our services like we've done with radiotherapy services in Derry? How do we develop Derry to become a centre of excellence for cancer care so patients in the northwest of the country can access services? How do we develop that the northern part of our country from Galway to Dublin, that line across the map, all the way up for patients, whether they're living in Northern Ireland or living in the Republic of Ireland? So thank you.
Thanks very much, Evelyn, for that question. And I know there, you know, there has been very good results to date, really, from patients in the Republic going to Alt na Galvan for cancer services. And there seems, as you pointed out, an appetite for more of that. And how can we do that? So, Damien, I'm going to come to you first, please, to address that question.
Yeah, so a couple of points. I think you've both referred to the Northwest Cancer Centre, and actually some of the points Len made earlier in relation to the key ingredients of making those sort of services work. About clinical leadership being really important, about patient focus. I was interested in the point about the independent chair and those sort of models, but I think there's some very interest in learning from that and other initiatives, and indeed from the Northwest Cancer Centre development itself. That has been fairly successful. It has taken time. It took time to develop, it took time to get agreement, time to fund, time to align the strategies in the two jurisdictions, to get clinicians on board. So I do think it does take perseverance and time to make those sort of solutions work. If you look at then how you could build that out, which I think is the central theme of the question, clearly the areas you've got to look at there is there's a degree of policy alignment. There's a piece about clinical leadership being aligned and engagement at that level to make sure that that can work. And that has been a success factor, not just in the cancer services in Alt na Galvan, but also in terms of cardiac services, you know, where people in Donegal who previously had to be routed to Sligo or onto Galway or Dublin are now able to come in to Alt na Galvan. And that has resulted in people's lives being saved. You know, we have numbers on that. So I think we have evidence that supports the development of those services. I think, again, they still need to be evidence-based. I live in Sligo myself, so I know the border region, and again, the geographical nature of it. But I do think it's important it's evidence-based. And part of the rationale for the Northwest Cancer Centre at the time was that it gave a population number that justified that service in relation to its development for radiotherapy. So I think what I would say in summary is, I think there needs to be policy alignment, clear patient focus about evidence base in terms of whatever the service may be, a cancer service or indeed any other service. And then I suppose all of the elements Len referred to, and we would have seen that experience in many, many projects through COT, those ingredients then need to be in place once there's a sort of consensus about what the evidence is telling us and what supports the decision in relation to the placement of the services. And look, it was a very emotional decision in the South, those of us that were around at the time, in relation to placement of the centres of excellence. And look, the example in Alt na Galvan, I suppose, is a good example of how there's some balance there, north-south, in terms of addressing some of those geographical issues that can sometimes emerge. But I think it's ultimately about using the evidence to support where the services should be placed. And in some cases, that also links into population, but factoring in other factors such as geography and so on, and access to services and people's willingness and ability to respond to that, maybe where distance, which I think is one of the other factors that's been noted there, could be a factor in terms of people making decisions about accessing or using the service.
Thanks very much, Damien, for your insight there. And I'm going to come, Len, really for your thoughts as well as a clinician on that particular question.
First of all, I'm not a clinician, so that's the important thing to say. But I think Damien has really cracked most of the issues here. I think we have to be realistic and say all of these things need really good business plans. You know, they need to stand up. Everything we talk about today is very compelling, and it would be nice to have them all. But ultimately, there is there's limited resource. So if so much needs to go into the planning before that to actually really not just have the shared vision, but then to say, well, how does that work out in a strategy that will bring people together and a business plan that will stand up when you go to the various departments to get funding and multi-year funding, which is essential.
Thanks very much. And I suppose as the point has come across as well, it can be a very emotional topic about where services are actually located, and particularly as we know, in cancer care there. Deirdre, I'm going to come to you really, I suppose, for what, you know, your insight really from the research that you carried out there about that.
Well, I suppose it's interesting that we talk about evidence-based policies and we accept that term without any critique. And in terms of policy, I think it's important to have a reflection on whose evidence, in terms of whose voice is heard. And I think there is a frustration in the Northwest that they feel their voice isn't as well heard as perhaps other people's voices. So when we're talking about evidence-based, I think we have to look at the whole policy-making process and say, well, where can this evidence be considered? Who's collecting it? And where is it being considered? Is it being considered at the highest level, for example? So I think that is a key issue. Evidence-based policy is not motherhood and apple pie, far from it. I suppose that takes me to the wider point then of saying, in terms of strategy and policy, cross-border collaboration and this type of work, really what a key thing that came from the research is there is a lack of overarching strategy in this area. And that then leads to fragmentation and duplication and gaps and a feeling that this type of work is not mainstream, but somehow outside the mainstream, that if it happens, it may be innovative and creative, but it isn't the main work of health policy. And I think we do have to change that because we have to understand how can you get this on the agenda? How can you raise a particular issue, many issues raised? How do you get that to be a talking point? How is the evidence collated, the data collated, for example? So I think really there is a need for a strategic direction in this particular policy area. So if we look this week, for example, we have the publication of the 10-year mental health strategy in the North. We've been waiting on the strategy for a very long time. We were the only region of the UK without an overarching strategy. There's no mention of cross-border health in it, no mention of cross-border initiatives. And yet a key policy area that individuals in this research identified that was a possibility, a potential for future collaboration was the whole area of mental health. And I suppose if you take the learning that we have from COVID-19, where we know that some digital interventions have been hugely successful in the area of mental health in a way that we couldn't have imagined, such as online counselling, well, really doesn't matter where that counselling is delivered from, as long as it works and it's effective. But by doing that, you also free up resources for the more complex, complicated interventions that require face-to-face interventions. So I suppose the question is, who's actually looking at this? Where does the strategic overview lie? And where is the policy alignment?
Thanks very much, Sarah. I think you emphasise that any changes we do make have to be evidence-based. And I know with the reorganisation of cancer services in the Republic, you know, that took time to communicate to people that the reason they are being reorganised is because we will get better outcomes, you know, through pooling resources and putting people in centres of excellence. And I suppose even for cross-border cancer care, again, that not only is it going to be more convenient for you, but that your outcomes will be better by going to this particular centre close to you. And you made some very interesting points there on mental health, which we will actually be exploring a bit more later on this afternoon in panel three. So thank you for your points on that. So the next question for the panel that we have now is from Vicky McGrath from the Rare Disease Ireland network. So she has some very interesting questions just about rare diseases and where we can collaborate further on them.
Hi, and thank you very much for this opportunity. It's a really interesting topic of conversation this morning. I guess my question relates to, or does relate to, rare diseases, and the nature of them is that it's very difficult to have expertise, and certainly to have expertise across 6,000 different rare diseases within Ireland or on the island of Ireland is very difficult. So my question would be to Dr. O'Hagan, is any advice on how we can build on the amazing model for the Congenital Heart Disease Network to, I guess, gather the resources across the island to work to the benefit of patients and families. What the success that you have had is definitely something that we want to build on, be it in basic genetic services, genetic diagnostics, and right down to treatments for individual rare conditions where there may only be two or three patients on the island with a particular condition.
Thanks very much for that question. And over to you, Len, really, because I think, you know, the creation of the All-Ireland Congenital Network really has put out there a great blueprint for other potential services.
Yeah, well, I think it's identifying that need, you know, the patient need, and to have it provided as close to the patient's home as possible. And I think if that's kind of the North Star that we start off with, then we kind of build on that. I mean, I think once you have that, the policy issue may follow. We have to be careful because there is a political element to all policy development and implementation. So I think if we're focusing on that real patient need, and then to build an alliance of people around you, and it really is back to the clinicians, got to be clinician led, it's got to have the patient or the family involvement. So those are the two important things. And then obviously to bring in whatever other areas, statutory areas or hospital areas or treatment areas, but they've got to believe that there is a need and that they can do something to help it. I mean, we also link into the networks in GB as well. And perhaps as you describe the issue that some specialist areas, and it's the same on the island as well, some of the pediatric respiratory ECMO is carried out now in Sweden for ROI patients and in Glasgow for NI patients. So we've got to that network that you're thinking about developing. It may well be that it's Northern Ireland to Scotland as much as and from Northern Ireland to England and back into the Republic of Ireland. So it's trying to build that network of common interest, but all built, I think, on the North Star of the the user's need and to deliver it as close as home to possible, because that gives integrity to what you're trying to do and it makes it resilient to the many obstacles and bad actions you're going to face along the implementation journey. So, but I'm very happy to talk to you offline in relation to how our experience, and I'm also very conscious ours might be unique. There might be elements that do work and there might be elements that aren't relevant.
Thanks very much, Len, for that contribution. That's very generous of you as well. And I know with rare diseases as they are, they might be individually rare, but a lot of people do actually are impacted by rare diseases across the island and they can feel very alone. So obviously fostering closer connections, whether that be supportive or connecting together as an island to get help from other European countries under the European reference network for rare diseases. You know, there's a lot of progress, I think, being made behind the scenes there. So hopefully further will happen. So next we're going to go to a question from Karen Charnley from the All Ireland Institute of Hospice and Palliative Care on a very important topic, because everyone does need end-of-life care, and what can we look at across the island really, I suppose, to collaborate on in this particular area?
The All Ireland Institute of Hospice and Palliative Care proactively supports researchers via our Palliative Care Research Network from across the island of Ireland to collaborate on research with a focus on improving the care of people with life-limiting conditions. Delighted to hear today about the HRB's changing policy, which will now allow researchers from Northern Ireland to lead on funding applications into the HRB. I'm just wondering what further can be done to support collaborations between researchers and clinicians across the island.
Question, and Deirdre, I'm going to come to you to answer that, please.
Well, I suppose you won't be surprised to know that as an academic, I'm going to fly the flag for academic research and the need for additional academic research, but academic research that can be used in the widest sense. Happily, academia has moved away from the idea of writing reports which don't have impact or aren't going to be used in the wider policy information. So I think it really is important that we talk about how we share knowledge, how we share information, and how we disseminate information. So Len has talked about his network, and I've talked to Len about his network extensively. But I think the issue is, how do we get his information out there as a case study? What were the critical factors? As he rightly says, there may not be a one size fits all. It may be that was a particular issue dealt with in a particular way and the stars aligned.
But there are broader issues around governance and how we address issues of governance and policy making. And I really think it is important that part of this initiative will be ensuring that we have research in the right areas, but research that's not sitting in splendid isolation, but it is actually working with those policymakers, with people in the community, with the voluntary and community sector, to address what the particular needs are and then look at how we can develop best practice in this area. I think a key difficulty in terms of academic research at the moment is it's not really clear how you go to find out what's happening, who's doing what, where are the networks that already have been established. If you're interested in a particular research area, how then do you get involved in that network? So I think there is a little bit of work to do in terms of how we share our knowledge, how we share good practice. And in terms of healthcare, it's really all about collaboration and cooperation. So how do we get to work with the people who are leading in that area? And how do we form those partnerships between academia, health, and I think as COVID-19 has shown us, and the business community, to ensure that we get the best outcomes and can deliver economies of scale?
Thanks very much, Deirdre, for answering that. Some very good points there from you. And next, we're going to go to Sharif Labriche from New Communities Partnership on a very interesting question, I think, that I will go to Damien on about vaccination issues and supporting people there. Turn on your mic, please. Okay,
well, sorry, I think you have the wrong participant there. That wasn't my question.
Okay, apologies. Well, if you can actually give us your question, please, for the panel.
Thanks a lot for the opportunity. My question is really straightforward in terms of the vaccination program. And according to our experience working with ethnic minorities and migrants, a number of families basically and the communities and people want to get vaccinated due to a number of reasons. Mostly is a really cultural issue. There is a fear and a lack of engagement. I know that the HSE, they translated program into different languages, but it still is not enough. The lack of engagement from those isolated communities, especially Roma communities, for example, and documented workers as well. There is a lot of fear out there. Is there any shared strategy both for the South and the North that will be targeting ethnic minorities and to motivate them and also to encourage them to get to the vaccination program? Thank you very much.
Thanks for that question. And that's a very important topic about vaccine hesitancy in ethnic minority groups. And I know in the UK and in Northern Ireland, they do have more structured plans in place to address those particular issues and try and increase vaccination in those particular areas. And there's been very good data published on the uptake of the COVID-19 vaccine across the different minorities in certain countries. So that is something that really has to be addressed proactively. And are we doing enough of that in the Republic? And can we partner more with the North in relation to that, particularly around the border regions as well, to try and bring up the rate of vaccination for those patients? So over to you, Damien, please, for your thoughts on that as head of the HSE's vaccination programme for COVID-19.
Thanks, Priscilla. I'm going to take it in sort of two bits, if you like. First bit is at the collaboration level between the two jurisdictions. I mean, there is at a public health level between the two chief medical officers, there's regular meetings around not just vaccinations, but just the wider response to the pandemic. And then I suppose at HSE level, we would engage indeed with Northern Ireland and indeed have also engaged with Scotland and England in relation to learning, I suppose, about issues, particularly tricky issues like the one mentioned here. In terms of the approach in the South, I suppose it's largely predicated on trying to use existing relationships. We certainly have found, as the questioner has said, that there have been big take-up issues, lack of take-up issues in relation to some communities, and it has been very challenging. There was a group, if you like, or a cohort, as they're described, identified for those groups in terms of trying to give particular focus and look at opportunities. And I suppose what we have found has worked best is to try and engage those communities and look at what works best. So in some cases, it has actually been a preference to work in the mainstream, whether it's through centres or opening up general practice to those areas outside the normal age bounds that we might be working through in order to improve participation. With other communities, it's using existing relationships, providers that maybe that are trusted, some of the voluntary sector that work with those communities, or indeed some of our own public health colleagues that work with those communities to try and increase uptake. I would say for some communities, and particularly those mentioned of the Roma community, there are particular challenges, and we've done a lot of work through the existing services that are there, existing relationships that are trusted, and we have found that's the model that works best. And in some ways, we focus less on trying to capture the numbers. I know that gives a disadvantage in the public sense, but it's really about trying to see what channel, if you like, works most appropriately for those communities. And as I say, if I take one or two of the groups that we've worked with, their preference was very much to route the majority through mainstream channels, but maybe opening up access on a more widespread basis rather than an age basis. And then where there were identified perhaps people then that were really difficult to reach, to do particularly targeted pieces of work to try and inform them. And I suppose with vaccination, our strategy is very much about trying to give people the information and let them make an informed choice around it for any individual. So I think we certainly have more to do. I wouldn't pretend that what's gone so far has resolved the issue. There's still more work to do, and we're continuing to do that. And there certainly are communities where the challenges are much greater, even where we've used established relationships, we've used partnerships that might be there already, we've used groups that are advocating for those groups to try and perhaps encourage take up and encourage that at least people have the right information to make those decisions. And we have seen it with some of the communities where there's been very significant outbreaks as a consequence. And I think Anthony Breslin in the previous discussion was even alluding to that along the border areas, where there are groups that clearly cross over and back. So at public health level locally, there's been engagement to try and see what can we do to make sure that the messages are consistent north and south. But undoubtedly, there's more that can be done. And certainly on those difficult to reach groups, our strategy is very much based on trying to continue to work with it extensively rather than, you know, short bursts that may produce some results, but then don't sustain themselves in terms of the risk for those communities through the lifetime of the COVID vaccination programme.
Thanks very much, Damien. And that is obviously a very important area, I suppose, on working together more so because of the impact of the pandemic. So it's good to see what's happening there in the background, and hopefully what more is going to come. And the data is very useful, again, from what has been happening through the NHS and their approach. So the next question that we're going to go to is from Eilish Hardiman, who is the Chief Executive of Children's Health Ireland. So if you can please let us know your question for the panel.
Thanks very much. First of all, say thank you to the panel. That has been a very engaging discussion, and it really resonates with me as a senior manager in a health service provider, the points that actually have been made. I want to build on maybe the previous points that have been made, particularly Len, in relation to the congenital heart disease, and also the previous speakers in relation to rare diseases. And obviously I'm going to focus on acute pediatric services. And I'm just wondering if we can, through this Shared Island initiative, set up some working room around acute children's services on the island, because both north and south, we are actually sending children abroad that if collectively we worked together, we could probably be able to develop services on the island that actually would mean that, like that family had demonstrated, that they are near their home and closest to the home as a key policy position, north and south. So that's my question, to see how to have some action out of this dialogue, and to particularly focus on those elements of acute services that are rare, acute services that have small numbers, acute services that actually require highly specialist and highly maybe competent skill sets, to actually drive some real collaboration from a health policy perspective first, but also, as Len identified, has some practical business case examples to see what's feasible and get funding to actually make it happen. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Eilish. I'm going to come to you, Len, obviously, for that question. Please, for your thoughts.
Thanks, Eilish. And I should just like to recognise Eilish, you know, as a major mover in the whole of our network, and to say that Crumlin really have been terrific in making it work. It's a clinical cooperation and relationships built up between Crumlin and the Royal really allowed this to happen. But what we did, and Eilish knows this, we took the issue really of trying to solve a problem, really this terrible problem for families and children going across the water. But we said, okay, fine, let's try and be larger than that and say, let's create a world-class service for the island of Ireland. And that really gets everyone sort of into contributing and finding that they're part of the network and part of the vision and part of moving it forward. And we have, I suppose, through all that cooperation, managed to build up a network that continues to develop, but it has a specific remit. And to move into the areas that Eilish talks about, and they're obvious ones, I think, for North-South All-Island cooperation. We need another format for that or another way of doing it. But I think, and Eilish would probably agree, I think the way of doing it, the same model that we used in terms of saying, well, look, what are we trying to do? And what's the patient outcome? And how can we build the business plan? And how can we get people on the island involved in it and want to be part of it? And also to say that we're in these specialist areas, we're a small island, so we've got to link into other countries in terms of doing it. But there's some immediate benefits to families and children, not big numbers, but that doesn't matter, because I think that the effect for the families is terrific. ECMO, we talked about, you know, pediatric postmortems. I mean, that's for Northern Ireland children, that's happening. That has to go across to Liverpool, which isn't really very good. And in the whole children cancer service, bone marrow transplant, some of the chemotherapies could be done in CHI with Eilish's organisation rather than going to GB. So those, but you know, the clinicians and people like Eilish know that. So all we've got to do essentially is to find a way of extracting that need and putting it into a business plan, and some of it may be overlap, and maybe we've got to bring a couple of services in together, and then to try and build a decent return on that investment that is going to get us what's going to be very, very hard in terms of the lack of funding as we move forward, because that's the reality. As we come out of COVID, it's going to be harder and harder to do it. So we've got to be, you know, I think slightly clever in terms of how we package these services and how to make them viable for a small island. But it's all possible. And I would, I think that those, what Eilish has identified in terms of ECMO and the other ones are relatively easily to be done. And it may not require a network to do it. It may just require CHI group dealing with a Royal or dealing with Glasgow or whatever. But we don't have yet a methodology for addressing that.
Len, thanks very much for your great insight into that and some really important points there about funding and the competing for funding, obviously, post-COVID, but I suppose as well the fact that it can be pointed out that by pooling resources and sharing structures that it will actually reduce costs and improve outcomes. So there's a lot there really for policymakers to take away. So we just literally have time now for one final question. I know there's a lot of them coming in there, so thank you very much, everybody. But I'm going to go now to Anne Watt, who is the director of Pivotal, independent public policy think tank for Northern Ireland. Please, for your question to the panel.
Thank you. Professor Heenan talked about the finding in her new research about enthusiasm for further cross-border cooperation in health, but the lack of a strategic framework to make change happen. And Dr. O'Hagan's description about the All-Ireland Congenital Heart Disease Network was really inspiring, but he also emphasised the importance of goodwill and cooperation and soft power rather than any legal powers being in place. So what do we need from researchers, policymakers, and political leaders to bring about greater cooperation in a wider range of services?
Thank you very much for that question. Deirdre, I'm going to come to you obviously to address that, please.
Well, that's quite a question to finish on. Thank you, Anne. I suppose what I would start off by saying is we have to articulate a common purpose, that it's not just cooperation or collaboration for the sake of it. And that's the first thing to say. And also, we didn't really have a chance to talk about, but I suppose the elephant in the room is that we have to have some acknowledgement of the political sensitivities around this whole issue of cooperation and how language is important and how people will hear something around integration differently than they might hear something around cooperation and collaboration. And so we have to think about the proposition that we're putting forward and how palatable it's going to be. So I think we have to be aware of the political sensitivities and the language that we use. So for example, people that I was talking to heard cross-border collaboration quite differently from all island health. And I just think we have to be sensitive to that and aware of it. But how we make it work is, I think we articulate a common purpose, but really what we're missing here to make this work is we have the enthusiasm, but we don't yet have the governance model. So what is the governance model that allows individuals, academics, and service users, importantly, to cooperate safely in a way that's influential, that allows us to get things done? Because part of the frustration of people that I was speaking to was they're saying, you know, this is sometimes like pushing water up a hill. We want to do it. The enthusiasm is there. The evidence is sometimes there, but it just seems to be an inordinately long process. So it's how we can get some strategic agreement, I think at a very high level. We're not talking about a detailed framework. We're not talking about a detailed policy. But we're agreeing on principles, and principles that are non-threatening, and principles that are ultimately focused on getting the best outcomes for the people who are living on this island and ensuring that we can deliver a world-class service. And I think to do that, we need a focus on economies of scale. We need a focus on value for money. We need a focus on clinical specialization, a focus on sharing knowledge, and a focus on saying that we have to ensure that our data systems are fit for purpose, that we are in a position to collaborate in a meaningful way. We talked earlier about the single patient record, and I think that's hugely important. So for me, how do we move forward? Being aware of the political sensitivities, but having a big picture overarching framework and being really clear as to what the Shared Island Unit can deliver in terms, I think, particularly here, in research and development, helping us to understand where the needs are and how they can be addressed using information across the world.
Thanks very much, Deirdre. Some really excellent points there. I think really, you know, signposting the way forward, and really a very nice way actually to finish up this panel discussion, because that is all we have time for. So thank you very much to our panelists for their insight and expertise this morning. And thank you for all those who submitted questions, and sorry to those that I didn't manage to get to, but there will be another opportunity to ask questions with the final panel this afternoon.